Have you ever seen these plants that ooze milky liquid and thought, hey, I wish I could use insects to eliminate those plants? Well, today might be your lucky day. If you've been to Canada or the States before, you've probably seen these plants. They've got these oddly shaped yellow flowers with no petals, and they can turn the landscape yellow when they're in bloom, which looks nice until you realize what that means. They've turned the landscape yellow. Where are the other colors? Not here, they're choking them out. See, these plants aren't from around here. They're originally from Europe and Asia, and like a lot of invasive plants, probably came accidentally mixed in with other hay or seeds for different grains. Possibly grains from Eastern Europe back in the early 1800s. But it took a while before people realized they weren't native to here, and by then they'd already started spreading. People would bring them mixed in with their seeds or mixed in with their hay, and they took that with them as they traveled across settling Canada and the States. So you can see a lot of it popping up along popular trails and railways. And because spurge contains some rather toxic chemicals and nothing here would really eat it, it put to use its enviably good reproductive biology. See, it puts together this unfortunate combination of being good at spreading and good at not dying. In terms of spreading, it has these exploding seed pods that can shoot its seeds a good 5 meters away. And those seeds, they can sit there for sprouting right away, or they can sit for a good 10 years just waiting for a favorable time to sprout. So you have one plant? Well, next year you may have a 10 meter wide crater of spurge just choking out all the other plants. And once it's growing, it'll put up a pretty tough fight to keep its spot. See, for its size, it has a ridiculous amount of root. The plant itself can grow about 1 meter above the ground, but underneath the ground, the roots can be a good 5 meters wide and 8 meters deep. So you're not digging this one up. So on top of sucking out the water and nutrients that other plants would otherwise take, and sometimes releasing chemicals that are bad for other plants, these roots are just covered in oodles of dormant buds, sitting there waiting to sprout. And so these buds, they're waiting for that above ground plant to die, in which case, even if they're a meter underground, they're going to come up and produce a whole new set of leaves and flowers. Now, if you've ever broken one of the leaves or stems on these plants, you've probably seen that it leaks a milky latex. And that's what earned this plant its other name of wolf's milk. I guess the assumption here was that a vile animal like a wolf would have vile-tasting milk. But anyway, don't eat it. The plant, that is. Wolf's milk, I don't think they sell anywhere, at least as far as I could find. But anyway, the latex has this irritating and toxic chemical called inguinal, which, if you get it on your skin, can give you rashes, and eaten, it can give you ulcers and other digestive issues, burn your esophagus. And the same thing kind of goes for cows. Sometimes they can eat it and even get sensitive to light after that, get rashes from the light. So, not recommended. The one exception to this is sheep and goats seem to be immune to the irritant, so they can eat it without issue. Other animals, not so much. And this plant has become a problem for both the environment and the economy, so it's pretty cut and dry that we do need to do something about this plant. See, on the economic side, if you're grazing cattle in a pasture, generally, they might try the spurge once, but probably not a second time, and so once they learn to avoid it, they'll just kind of avoid areas that have spurge in them. And as it spreads throughout the pasture, the actual usable area in that pasture shrinks. And this goes for wild animals as well, deer, bison, and other wild grazing animals. This isn't the only plant that does this in Canada, of course, and the States, but it is one of the main ones, one of the worst ones. Recent figures on this were hard to come by, but here in Manitoba alone, in 2010, it was estimated that about $40 million were lost each year due to this loss of grazing land. And that's just the quantifiable damage. Like, the change in ecology from the loss of food for wild animals has made huge impacts as well. And it's claimed a big chunk of North America now. It's in 10 Canadian provinces and territories and about 26 American states, which is why a lot of national parks and reserves have gotten involved in trying to tame this vegetative beast. So what's to be done about all this? How are we going to eliminate it, or at least tame it? Well, one simple thing that can be done around here, most animals can't eat it, but sheep can, and goats, and some of them can actually develop a bit of a preference for it. Now, there aren't oodles of sheep or goats around this area, but the local government did used to have a sheep grazing program that people could join in on to help control the local spurge. And it can take a while to actually kill the spurge with this method, because remember those dormant buds that keep popping up, but if combined with other methods, it can be pretty effective. But of course, this only really works in certain circumstances. In pastures, sure. In national parks, on boulevards, not so much. You can't just release an apocalyptic horde of sheep over the whole continent. In that respect, insects are a better choice. So none of the native insects eat this, but back in its home range, some of them do. And this can be risky, of course, introducing a new species to control an existing invasive one, like the story of the little old lady who swallowed a fly, and then swallowed a spider to catch the fly, and a bird to catch the spider, and so on like that. But if done carefully, and with a bit of luck, because it's hard to foresee every possible consequence, it can be very safe and effective. And for this, you need to make sure that this insect only eats the particular invasive species that you're trying to control. Otherwise, you could have another runaway invasive on your hands, now an insect. And you want this to be a self-sustaining control, too, so it's important that the insect is able to survive and thrive on its own here. Since the 60s, when they really started buckling down to find natural enemies for the spurge, a number of good options were found, and some of them you can still find roaming around here. But the easiest one to spread yourself, if you're having a spurge problem, are the flea beetles. As a note on this, these aren't the flea beetles that are eating your cabbage. Certain species of flea beetle are amongst the worst pests for canola, but it's a big group, with a lot of species being very picky about what species of plants they eat. And these ones only eat spurge. Also, flea beetles aren't a type of flea, like the kind that attacks animals. It's just called that because it jumps like a flea. If you have a problem with spurge, and letting sheep graze on your land isn't an option, you may be able to help spread these beetles yourself. Sometimes there's big events where people will get together and gather these from a place where they're particularly abundant, and then bring them back to their land where they can release them, to help control their own spurge. So let's take a look at how that's done. All you'll need is a cloth net and maybe a container to keep them in. If you're going to go collecting these, you'll need to do it when it's pretty dry and sunny. The beetles spend most of their time underground and only come up to feed in good weather, so midday on a non-windy day is generally pretty good. Here's Richard Warkentin demonstrating good sweep netting technique. Go near patches of spurge and sweep with a downward stroke, scooping through the top layer of the plants. Not so hard that you break off the tops of the plants, but enough that the insects won't just get shaken onto the ground. Once you've done a bit, check your net. How many flea beetles do you see? If you can get about 5 beetles per sweep, that's a pretty good indicator that there's enough there that you can spread them. If there's less than that, well, you don't want to kill off this colony, and you also want to have enough that your new colony doesn't die from too few members. Obviously, it's hard to count these individually, but 500 is a pretty good number for starting a new colony, which is about enough that if you pack them down, it would take about a teaspoon or 5 milliliters. A film canister actually could hold about 5,000, though I'm not sure if my younger audience members will know what that is. If you're doing this by yourself, sorting them is going to be next to impossible, but for doing this on a larger scale, you might use a sorting machine like this. It's got a bucket up top with small holes punched in it, but otherwise it's closed off, so the beetles will be drawn out those holes towards the light and end up caught in the net funnel, which every now and again you shake it and get them to fall down into the container at the bottom. Once you have a good number of beetles, either sorted or just in your net, take them and just blop them out onto the ground somewhere where the spurge is thick. Don't spread them around too much. They're very social and gregarious insects, and they won't survive well if they can't have friends. So try to keep at least 500 in each new spot, and they'll spread themselves as time goes on. It's best to spread them as soon as you can, preferably the same day, but if you're going to wait a little bit longer, it's important to leave them room to breathe in that container. So don't pack them too tight, and leave them spurge leaves to eat in the meantime. Leave them in a cool place too. Even a fridge is good, because like most insects, when they get cold, they slow down and need less food. But best release them as soon as possible. These insects don't do too well in sandy places or places where there isn't much snow cover, but otherwise they're great because they only eat the leafy spurge. And that goes for both the adults and the larvae. The life cycle varies between species a bit, but generally the adults lay eggs on the plant in summer. These hatch in a few weeks and go on to tunnel through and munch on the plant's roots until sometime next year. In the spring or early summer, they emerge as an adult and now eat the above ground parts of the plants, the leaves and the flowers. By this point, the plant is usually pretty dead, either directly from the eating damage or indirectly from infected wounds. And then the insects can continue their cycle of laying about 250 eggs around the plant in the soil. And so the cycle continues. As you can imagine, these are teensy insects, and they like to stick together, so it can take a while before you see much for results. The first year, you might see a crater with no spurge that spreads outward little by little. The 10-year mark is where you should be able to see the full results. This pasture here is a great example. 15 years ago, it looked more like this. Very little area to graze for anything but sheep, and a lot of plants getting choked out by the spurge. So they released some spurge beetles around when that picture was taken. 15 years later, the difference is night and day. Like, there's a couple near the top of the hill, the odd one here or there in the pasture. So it is still here, but it's not doing much. They monitored here for the first 10 years and noted a 85% decrease in the number of spurge plants, probably less now, and that's the average. So it includes a lot of testing areas where it was a total 100% elimination, and also some that weren't so great as that. And that's the thing though, at this point, unless there's a major scientific breakthrough, spurge is naturalized. It's too late to eradicate it. Like, maybe in a small area, if you're willing to do this, plus several other strategies combined, put in a lot of work. But it's too late to kick it out of North America entirely. We are just trying to make it play fair. If we can get it down to 2 or 3%, well, then it might just become a viable part of the Canadian-American landscape. So anyway, if you live in Canada or the States, this is a good plant to know, and one that perhaps you might be able to help control as well. But that's all I have for today. This video was brought to you by the Stanley Soil Management Association. They provide environmental goods and services here in South Central Manitoba, and with a focus on planting and maintaining shelter belts. And they've also been working to help control leafy spurge in the area for a while now. So, a big thank you to SSMA for that. As always, if you have any corrections, suggestions, or disparaging remarks, feel free to comment that down below. And if you enjoyed this and would like to see more, liking and subscribing always really helps me out. I'm hoping to film about a few more Canadian plants before they all die for the winter. Might have a few more Papua New Guinea videos in the tube, depending when I release this. But anyway, for more exploration of the plant kingdom, join me next time on Ambling with Sam.